morning, everybody. As you saw on that video, we're actually going to be hosting a Journey of Generosity Day here at the cathedral. And you can find all the information on the website. And what we're really going for with that is how do we become better disciples of Jesus through our generosity? As they said, this organization that's coming in and helping us out with this, they're not asking for our money, but they're trying to help us see what the scriptures say about what does it look like to be a generous disciple of Christ. So I want to invite you to that. You can find all that information on our website. As Elvin said at the beginning, there's a QR code on the back of your chairs, and all of that will be on the website. So, or the app, the Church Center app. So please join us for that, the Journey of Generosity, and we look forward to seeing you. And as we talk about generosity, we're going to go into our time of giving. And what we do as a church and how we give is out of a generous heart. We see many, many times in Scripture how Jesus says that where your money is, there your heart is also. So I'm going to pray for our giving. There's a box in the back. There's ways to give on the screen. Yep, there's ways to give on the screen. And that's just for you to have the chance to bless the church with the resources that God has ultimately given you for the kingdom work that Harvest is doing here in Chicagoland and beyond. So let me pray for that. Lord, we give you thanks. We want to be a generous people, God, so help us. Lord, we need the conviction of your Holy Spirit. We need to not hold on to things so tightly, Lord, so help us. Lord, it's hard, so help us. And Lord, I pray that the resources that are given to this church would go to impact your kingdom here on this earth, God, and that those things would multiply, the gospel would multiply here in Chicagoland and beyond for your glory alone. Lord, we pray in Jesus' name, amen. All right, so we're going to jump into the Word now. My name is Luke. If we haven't met, I would love to meet you after. I'll be up here. I'm on staff here. And I just want to, we're going to be in Habakkuk, so if you want to open your Bibles to Habakkuk chapter 3. And as I explained a couple weeks ago, we're in this series on the prophets, and we're kind of doing these quick dives in and out of these books. So we're in a book each and every week. But to understand Scripture, we need to understand who the author is, why he's writing this, why the people that he's writing to needed to hear this, and then how do we apply it to our lives. So I'm going to give us a quick description. So Habakkuk is only three chapters. It's a short book, but it has a lot in it. And as I was reading it this week and as I was preparing for this message, it's actually not too far off of how I'm feeling and maybe how you're feeling about the state of our world. So this book is actually interesting in the prophets that he's not actually writing to a people, but it's a dialogue between Habakkuk and God. It's not, hey, Israel, this is what you should do. It's, God, this is how I'm feeling. Now answer how I'm feeling. So this book is a dialogue between Habakkuk and God, and it goes into a pretty simple formula. It's a complaint, and then God answers. It's a complaint, and then God answers, and then we're going to dive into chapter 3, which is Habakkuk's prayer. But in chapter 1, verses 2 through 4, I read this, and I couldn't help but write down in my Bible, this is true today, too. So Habakkuk 1, 2 through 4 says, O Lord, how long shall I cry for help and you will not hear? Or cry to you violence and you will not save? Why do you make me see iniquity and why do you idly look at wrong? Destruction and violence are before me, strife and contention arise, so the law is paralyzed and justice never goes forth. For the wicked surround the righteous, so justice goes forth perverted. How many of you at one point or another, maybe even this week, have felt this? Yeah. How many of you at one point or another have felt, God, do you even care? God, what's going on here? Why are you not intervening? When we see violence and wickedness run rampant. So I titled this sermon, God, Do You Not Care? Because that's what I feel Habakkuk is asking, and I feel like that's a question that, if we're honest with ourselves, we've asked at one point or another. So the sermon's actually only going to be 2 points, and we're going to read verses 1 through 16 all in one big chunk. So I really want you to follow along either on the screen or in your Bible, on your phone or your hardcover Bible. And I really want us to see this. What Habakkuk is doing here, this prayer is actually meant to be like a song. So if you think of the Psalms, there's a lot of Psalms that have poetic language, and you don't take them necessarily at face value because there's a lot of symbolism or imagery. Like, I could eat a whole horse. Like, you don't take that literally when I say that. You just think, wow, he's really hungry. So let's read verses 1 through 16. The first point is God's kingdom will never end. God's kingdom will never end. So starting in verse 1 of chapter 3, a prayer of Habakkuk the prophet, according to Shigonoth. O Lord, I have heard the report of you and your work. O Lord, do I fear. In the midst of the years, revive it. In the midst of the years, make it known. In wrath, remember mercy. God came from Taman, and the Holy One from Mount Paran. His splendor covered the heavens, and the earth was full of his praise. His brightness was like the light. Rays flashed from his hands, and there he veiled his power. Before him went pestilence, and plague followed at his heels. He stood and measured the earth. He looked and shook the nations. Then the eternal mountains were scattered. The everlasting hills sank low. His were the everlasting ways. I saw the tent of Cushan in affliction. The curtains of the land of Midian did tremble. Was your wrath against the rivers, O Lord? Was your anger against the rivers, or your indignation against the sea when you rode on your horse, on your chariot of salvation? You stripped the sheath from your bow, calling for many arrows. You split the earth with rivers. The mountains saw you and writhed, and raging waters swept on. The deep gave forth its voice. It lifted its hands on high. The sun and moon stood in their place at the light of your arrows as they sped at the flash of your glittering spear. You marched through the earth in fury. You threshed the nations in anger. You went out for the salvation of your people, for the salvation of your anointed. You crushed the head of the house of the wicked, laying him bare from thigh to neck. You pierced with his own arrows the heads of his warriors. You came with a whirlwind to scatter me. Rejoice as if to devour the poor in secret. You trampled the sea with your horses, the surging of the mighty waters. I hear and my body trembles. My lips quiver at the sound. Rottenness enters into my bones. My legs tremble beneath me. Yet I will quietly wait for the day of trouble to come upon the people who invade us. The first point is God's kingdom will never end. Habakkuk here, he has heard of what God has done. He's looking back at who God has proven himself to be time and time again. There's a lot of this imagery is coming from the Exodus, when God's people were taken out of Egypt. A lot of this imagery is taken from when God had proven himself to be faithful to his promise. We also see a similar thing where Habakkuk here is basically saying, God, you've done it before. I've seen your power. I've seen your might go before me. We see a lot of this actually in the book of Job. If you're not familiar with the book of Job, he was basically the guy that had it all, and then all of it was taken away. His wealth, his family, his health. Everything was taken away from Job. And as we know as people, when things are taken away or we feel like, God, I feel like I'm living a righteous life, but it feels like time and time again, the things aren't going my way. Job was angry with God. He was angry in the sense of, God, why is this happening to me? He was angry in a similar way that Habakkuk was angry. God, why are you letting other people conquer your people? Why are you not doing anything when I'm trying to live a righteous life here? And then whenever I'm feeling in this way, or whenever I'm feeling like I'm a little bit more important than I should feel, I always, always go to Job 38 through 41 to humble me. This is my translation or summary of basically what God says in those three chapters. So God, as Job is annoyed with God, or he's confused at his circumstances, God says, what was it like when the foundations of the world were made? Hey, Job, tell me what it was like when the foundations of the world were made. Job, it's so cool that the water stops where it does and the land starts. Is that what you did? It was a great idea to have night and day, Job. Wait, well done. Thanks for sending the rain to the ground when it needs it, Job. Because, like, you're telling me how to do my job, so you obviously did all of these things. Job, nice job with the lightning and the thunder. That's a really good touch that you had. You did great creating all of those animals of the earth and sustaining them. Well done. Oh, you know, like those remote animals on mountains that can climb up mountains and do it so easily, and you know when each of those are born, right? Not to mention all the good things that man has. You did good by providing all of those things. And then as Job is getting, it's a really funny path. There's a lot of like sarcasm by God of like, hey, you know I did all of this, so calm down a little bit, Job. And then we see in chapter 42 of Job, verses 1 through 6, then Job answered the Lord and said, I know that you can do all things and that no purpose of yours can be thwarted. Who is this that hides counsel without knowledge? Therefore, I have uttered what I do not understand, things too wonderful to me, which I do not know. Hear, and I will speak. I will question you, and you will make it known to me. I had heard of you by the hearing of the ear, but now my eyes see you. Therefore, I despise myself and repent in dust and ashes. Job is actually brought low in the magnificence of God. And that's how each and every one of us, no matter what circumstances you are feeling, we should be brought low in the magnificence of God. I every time I'm feeling like pride is boiling up in me, or there's something that, oh man, I'm doing such a great job, I go to this to humble myself. Because there's so much things that are going on in this universe that God is with, he is upholding. And I am just a speck in that. So who am I to question the Creator? Just as Job feels this reality, Habakkuk is feeling this reality too. He's saying, God, I'm looking at the things that you've done, so I'm holding fast to the promises that you have made. There's another character in the Bible that is one of my biblical heroes, actually the first martyr of the Christian faith, Stephen. So in his speech in Acts chapter 7, basically he's talking to the Israel audience who would have known all of the Old Testament scriptures. He's talking to the people that would have known them the best. And he gives a summary, basically, of the entire Old Testament. And he says that God removed Abraham and his family from the land that actually Israel inherited after that. And God promised an inheritance to Abraham to a man who had no children and was old in age. God also told Abraham of a coming enslavement and a misplacement of his people. And then he also told him that there was a promise of deliverance. A deliverance from Egypt, the very deliverance that Habakkuk is looking back to. God told Abraham, this is what you have to look forward to. What a lot of the prophets would look back to and remind God's people of God's faithfulness was the promise that God gave Abraham to look forward to. And that happened by Joseph being sold into slavery by his own family, his own brothers. God rescuing him after that, him being sold, through many trials and afflictions, God gave him favor with the king of Egypt, the Pharaoh. Then came a famine, and Joseph saved the very people that sold him into slavery. This is what Stephen's explaining to the Jewish leaders, all of the things that they know, and a lot of the things that you all know too. And then God said, he brought it back to the original promise that he promised Abraham, that Abraham's descendants would multiply in Egypt. So from the guy that had no children, now there's a multiplication of people in the very land that's oppressing them. Then the people were mistreated and abused, and Moses is born. But he's born during a time where there's a decree that they should kill all of the young boys. So his mother puts him in a basket down the river, and he's picked up by none other than the Pharaoh's daughter who adopts him. So he's brought up as an Egyptian. He defends someone who's being wrong and avenges them. He thinks that this is going to be looked upon by the Israelites as such a great thing that happened, but instead they call him a murderer and he has to flee the country. So he goes into exile and he fathers two children at that time, and 40 years pass where he's probably saying the exact same thing. God, why is the wicked reigning in Egypt? Why are you not rescuing the people? Why are you not rescuing your people? So God calls him out of this exile to go and save his people. And he leads them in this exodus through these many plagues and these many miracles that God has, the very same thing that Habakkuk is looking back to and holding on fast to the promise of God. And he leads the people out, and then they're in the wilderness for another 40 years. And I'm sure that there's many questions and many things that are going on in Moses and the people's hearts that are saying, God, why are we still suffering? Why is this happening? And Moses is constantly brought up by the people saying, let's go back to Egypt. It was better. The very people that were oppressing them and abusing them and enslaved them, they said, it was better there. And God helped to reclaim the promised land after this 40 years. And then throughout the Old Testament, there are kings and prophets of the people that people kept rejecting. And they kept following in the ways of the world. They kept doing the wickedness, the people, God's people of Israel. And then at the end of Acts 7, Stephen says this in verse 51, you stiff-necked people. He's saying this to the people in Jesus' time, after he told them about the history of Israel, in which they were saying, oh, we'll never fall for that. We'll never be like those people. You stiff-necked people, uncircumcised in hearts and ears, you always resist the Holy Spirit. As your fathers did, so do you. Which of the prophets did your fathers not persecute? And they killed those who announced beforehand the coming of the righteous one, whom you have now betrayed and murdered. You who receive the law as delivered by angels and do not keep it. Stephen says this to the people that are supposed to know that the Holy One, the righteous one of God, was Jesus Christ, and they totally missed it. He says that. And this is what Habakkuk is also saying. He's like, guys, don't miss this. We're doing evil in the sight of the Lord. So he's going to bring a conqueror to conquer us who's even more wicked, but that's going to serve God's purpose. And God will punish them in due time, but he's punishing us right now because of our wickedness, because of our hardness of heart, because we are a stiff-necked people. That is what Habakkuk is crying out to the Lord. Lord, why is this happening? Because they were a stiff-necked people. So what do we ask about this as the church today? Why is there so much violence? If we go back to that chapter 1, God, do you not see the violence that is happening? Do you not see the wicked that seemingly are reigning here on earth? God, why are you not moving? Why is this happening? God, why are you not intervening? We all have asked this question that Habakkuk has asked. And I want us to look back just as Habakkuk did in chapter 3 and look back at all of the things that God has done. All of the promises from the scripture that he says will be fulfilled have been fulfilled or are going to be. We can look at the book of Revelation and we know how it ends. Multitudes of people at the feet of Jesus. Jesus' return to earth. We know that that's going to happen. Why do we know that? Because he has never lied in the past. Let's look at it this way. If I promised you 100 things and I made good on those promise of 100 things, if I promised you a thing the next day, I have a pretty good track record of those things that I promised I'll do. So you would have a lot of faith in me that, hey, he's probably going to get that done because he's 100 for 100. But if I promised you 10 things and didn't do any of them, my next promise, you're probably not even picking up my phone call because I have a bad track record of not fulfilling that. What Habakkuk is saying here and what his prayer is, and what Stephen is saying here, and what his prayer is, and what God told Job is, you know what? I'm batting 1,000. I have never made a promise that hasn't come to fruition. I've never promised anything. I promised a guy who had no children, who was advanced in years, that he would have a multitude of people, and look at him now. And we can hold fast to those promises too. And if you need extra assurance of this, God is still moving today in so many incredible ways, even in our city and even around our world. If you think, like, you can, I love that we have those posters at the back of the church because it's such a humbling thing. We see the posters at the top of the stairs is, most of you, a lot of you have written down names of people that don't know Jesus that we pray for each and every Tuesday, and our prayer team prays for those people. But to the right of that list are people that God has actually saved within the last 2 years of those lists. And there's a lot more people on the left list of people that need to be saved than on the right. But even one name on the right is something that should be celebrated, should be praised, should be glorified to God, that's a living proof that God is still working. That's a living proof that people that have direct contact with people in our church are being saved by the Almighty God through his gospel. That is something that we should rejoice and praise. God is still moving. And if you want to go on a bigger scale, you're like, yeah, that's great, but like, what's going on? Like, if you want to go on a bigger scale, if I asked you to probably name the countries around the world that you think that, hey, that in that country, God is, there's no way he can move, whether it's through persecution or government oppression. I think some of the names that would probably come up on that list would be Iran, who their entire government is the Islamic, that's their government. So God can't be moving there, right? There's actually estimates of over 1 million Christians in Iran, and that's growing each and every day. And you ask, how is that possible? Through government oppression, how is that possible? And trust me, if you're a follower of Christ in Iran, you're not a nominal believer, which means you're a Christian by name only. There's not a lot of people that are like, hey, I'm a Christian, and then living a life that's not Christ-like. Because If you claim to be a Christian, there's heavy persecution, and you'll probably be exiled by your family. That's the least of your worries, and death is the biggest of your worries. So you're not going around flaunting, hey, I believe in Christ, in a place like Iran. And there's over 1 million believers, and most of those are in house churches of 10 to 15 people because they can't gather in large spaces. God is moving. Another country that you would probably think of is North Korea. There's no way there can be any Christians in North Korea. The government is, they're not allowing that. There's actually been North Koreans that have been sent to Afghanistan to do work that are actually secretly living as missionaries, and they're sharing the gospel to people in Afghanistan. And people are coming to know Christ in Afghanistan through North Korean missionaries that are being sent there for work. That's the God we serve. That's the God that is, he is still moving. God is still working, even in the places that we're like, there's no way God is moving and working. There are churches all around the city that are proclaiming the gospel, and God is still transforming lives through the work of the Holy Spirit. Even in a city that when we read the news, it doesn't look like God is here at all. God is still moving. He's like, and we see he's doing an amazing, like I was researching a lot of this week, and there's some things that I've heard before that it just really excites me. There's the stats of Muslims coming to Christianity. So a definition of a Christian movement is at least 1,000 believers being baptized or 100 new churches starting. So that's the definition of a movement, a Christian movement. So in the years 600 to 1800, there were zero known movements among the Islamic population in all of the world. It's a long stretch, and there's no movement. From 1800 to 1980, there were two known movements. So that, again, that's at least 1,000 people being baptized or 100 new churches being started. From 1800, so 180 years, there were two known movements. In 1980 through 2000, there were 11 known movements. And from 2000 to now, there has been 69 plus known movements in Islamic regions for Christianity. In the span of 20 years, there's over, if you do the very bare minimum of math, that's 69,000 baptisms. And that's the very bare minimum. That's what we're seeing God move in our world. We're seeing this. So why would we question, is God still there? God, are you still there? God, do you not care? God cares, and he cares deeply about his church. And he is moving in our world. So has life gotten in the way of understanding that? Have you been struggling? I don't know what it is for you. Are you struggling with the sickness of you or a loved one? Are you struggling with financial insecurity, job insecurity? Are you struggling with fear? The fear of tomorrow, the fear of violence, the fear and anger of injustice in our world? Have those things gotten in the way? Have those things clouded what God's actually doing in your life and in this city and around the world? Because if it has, let's look around. Let's see what God's doing. Let's see what the Holy Spirit is doing through this movement that Christ initiated on the cross. So my question for you is, are you ready for your next trial? Are you ready for the next thing that might get in the way, that might have you questioning, just like Habakkuk did? God, are you even there? Don't you see what's going on? Are you ready for that next time? Or is your faith totally unprepared? Do you have times of God's faithfulness in your reserves to get you through a difficult time? We all have reserves, or we want reserves. We all have savings account for the rainy day, or we all have something that we put aside for security. Do you have anything in your faith reserves? Man, God, you really brought me through that really difficult time. I'm going to put that in my reserve. God, you really showed up in this magnificent way. I'm going to put that in my reserve. It's actually, God works in so many funny ways, especially when you're preparing a sermon. I was actually thinking about this like 3 weeks ago before I even looked at Habakkuk about what I was going to be preaching on. And there was a few nights in the last 3 weeks that I just couldn't sleep. I was just sitting there staring at the ceiling. God, help me sleep, because I'm tired. I know Judah's going to wake up soon and want to lay on me. And during that time, he actually brought me back to about 10 or 15 years ago. And like these things, these sins and these sin patterns that I was in just kept replaying in my mind. The way that I was chasing the world, the people that I hurt, the things that I did that I look back and I'm like, Lord, why was I like that? I don't even want to know that person. Lord, just remove these memories from me, because I hate who I was back then. But he also reminded me in that time of thinking, look who you are now, Luke. Look how the Holy Spirit has transformed you over the last 10 to 15 years. It's good that you grieve who you used to be. And in 10 or 15 years, he's probably going to keep me awake at some point, and I'm going to look back at this time and be like, man, why did I do that? Why? And that's the process of our sanctification. What sanctification is just becoming more like Christ. It's the Holy Spirit working in us and showing us, hey, this is where you're not living like me. Repent of that and be different. And God helped me, and a lot of those memories and a lot of those things are very painful to think about. I was not a good person. You can ask my parents. They prayed a lot. I was not a good person, and I hate who I was. And that's the Holy Spirit in me. And that's only the Holy Spirit in you. So your homework for this week, put some of that faith in your reserves for that next trial. Look back to who you were and who you are now. And if it's the same, I would really pray. But the Holy Spirit's in you, it's not going to be the same. Okay, so that was the first point. God's kingdom's not ending. Our second point, in the last couple verses of this, is our hope and joy are secure. Our hope and joy are secure. Verse 17, though the fig tree should not blossom, nor fruit be on the vines, the produce of the olive fail, and the fields yield no food, the flock be cut off from the fold, and there is no herds in the stalls, yet I will rejoice in the Lord. I will take joy in the God of my salvation. God, the Lord, is my strength. He makes my feet like deer's. He makes me tread on my high places to the choir master with stringed instruments. That last part is, that's how you should read this, or this is how you should sing this. With stringed instruments. Should have had a quartet up here or something. Let's look at what he's saying there. Back in those days, your wealth was tied to the produce that you had, or the abundance in your field, or how many how many herd, what you had in your herd of cattle, how much land you had. And he's saying all of these things are barren. There's no herd in the stalls. It's a wasteland. It's desolate. So you would think that in that, verse 18 is a little bit out of place, don't you? Yet I will rejoice in the Lord. How many of you, when you make a bad investment or you have to make a big purchase and you see your bank account go lower and your wealth starts to dry up a little bit, you're like, man, God, thank you. I'm going to rejoice in this. That's not our initial reaction. That's not a reaction that the world tells us to take. It's all right, now let's tighten up the purse strings. Let's not be generous now because things are looking a little more scarce. Our initial reaction isn't joy or rejoicement. But Habakkuk, after all of this, after him looking back at God's faithfulness, he's saying, even in the midst of this most difficult season, I will rejoice and take joy in the God of my salvation. There's a very difficult season going on, and Habakkuk is coming to terms with that moment. He is coming to terms with this very difficult reality that this conquering nation is going to come and conquer them because of the wickedness of the people. But even so, he has joy and security because of the fulfillment of the promise. And even more so, do we, in the year 2024, should we have joy in the fulfillment of this promise? What is that promise that we should find joy in and fulfillment in? If you're here today and you've never accepted Christ as your Savior and you've tuned me out, that's okay. Tune back in, because this is the most important part of the message. Why we can have joy in the midst of a barren season is because each and every one of us in here is a sinner, and we've separated ourselves from God. And what God did when he saw his creation turn their back on him, what he did is he had a plan. And what his plan was to send his son to do what he called us to do, and that was live a righteous life. A life in full obedience to God that we did not do because we fell short of that. We sinned and were separated. And now what we can hold joy and security in is Jesus was the Son of God, and he was sent by God, and he lived that perfect life that we were supposed to live. And he was persecuted by those very same people that Stephen was talking to earlier in the sermon. They didn't know or see the righteous one of God. He was the righteous one of God, and he actually died on the cross in yours and my place. Because there's this chasm that we cannot overcome on our own. No matter how many good works we do, no matter how much money we give or the things that we say, how nice of a person we are, we can never bridge that gap again after we have sinned. The only thing is to live perfectly, which we have not done, but Jesus did, and he bridged that gap for us. And he doesn't ask of anything of us other than believe that message. Believe that he came and lived a perfect life and died for your and my sins. That is the hope that we can have and the security that we can have, and that's the joy that we can cling to in the midst of very, very difficult seasons. In the midst of, God, why are you not there? Why are you not intervening? Why aren't you, God, you say you're all powerful. Just take all the wicked people and throw them into the abyss. Why aren't you doing that? That's the joy that we can have, the security that we can have. It's in Christ Jesus. That is the most important thing that you'll hear today or tomorrow or ever. And that's the most important thing the person that you care about, your friend that doesn't know Jesus, could ever hear, is that gospel, that good news that Jesus has died for your sins. So in light of God has never, ever not fulfilled his promise. He has always fulfilled his promise, every single time. And his promise was to send Jesus, and he has fulfilled that. And his promise is to return. So if he has a track record of batting 1,000, you better be ready, because he's returning. At the end of Acts chapter 7, verses 59 and 60, so Stephen says all of that, and after he calls them a stiff-necked people, and that's probably not the things that you should do to people with stones that are ready to kill you, they start stoning him. So, and as they were stoning Stephen, he called out, "Lord Jesus, receive my spirit." Which makes sense. Like, if you're being killed or persecuted or something, and you believe in Jesus, like, it makes sense. "Lord, receive my spirit. Lord, I'm doing this for you." But this is what doesn't make sense. Verse 60, "And falling to his knees, he cried out with a loud voice, 'Lord, do not hold this sin against them.' And when he had said this, he fell asleep." That first part makes sense to the world. Yeah, I want to save my own skin. "Lord, receive my spirit." And that second part, that only comes from a relationship and an indwelling of the Holy Spirit. That only comes from having joy in a difficult season. So do you have this joy and compassion for people? Do you have the same joy and compassion that Stephen had to his murderers, saying, "Lord, do not hold this against them"? Or do you fall in the camp of, "Lord, save me, and whatever else happens, yeah, that's fine"? Because a kingdom-minded people, we're always looking and hoping that the gospel message sinks into an unbelieving world. Do you have this joy and compassion for people because of what Jesus has done for you? Romans 5, 1 through 5 says, "Therefore, since we have been justified by faith, we have a peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. Through him we have obtained access by faith into this grace in which we stand, and we rejoice in the hope of the glory of God. Not only that, but we rejoice in our sufferings, knowing that sufferings produce endurance, and endurance produces character, and character produces hope. And hope does not put us to shame, because God's love has been poured into our hearts through the Holy Spirit who has been given to us." Church, we should rejoice in no matter whatever circumstance you are in. We should rejoice because this truth, that our hope is not going to put us to shame. That's a promise from God. And he has never not fulfilled his promise. Where is our hope? Our hope has to be in that. As we go out this week, really cling on to that hope. Fill up your faith reserves. We have a hope that is everlasting. And there's going to be difficult moments in your life. Maybe even today. Maybe tomorrow. Definitely within the next year. That we have to cling to a hope and this understanding that Jesus is the only way to eternal salvation. And he's the only way to your unbelieving friends having true fulfillment and joy in a world that doesn't want to give it to us. The world wants us to be scared. The world wants us to fear. But we have a hope that will never put us to shame. Let's pray. Father, I'm so grateful for your word, the word of truth, this word of hope. Lord, Lord, a lot of times it's so hard. When we're in the midst of our suffering, we can't see the endurance and the character and the hope. So, Lord, we need your help. But, Lord, you have given us the Holy Spirit, and that is all we need. So please reveal to us the ways that you have been faithful. Continue to reveal the ways that your promises are going to reign true now and forevermore. And Lord, we long for the day when there is no more pain, no more tears. Lord, we long for the day where this hope turns into reality, that we are at the feet of our risen Savior, seeing holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen.